the Galapagos. 180 years ago, these extraordinary islands sparked a revolution in science. Today, their potential to unlock secrets lies offshore, where five major ocean currents converge, bringing together an incredible diversity of life. Cold water creatures like penguins skim by, not far from tropical coral reefs. The unique conditions of these waters lure researchers, investigating some of the most pressing questions facing science today. What can the Galapagos tell us about saving the bounty of our oceans before it's too late? The Galapagos is a series of volcanic islands isolated in the eastern Pacific Ocean. Charles Darwin's visit here in 1835 helped shape his theory of evolution. Now, tourists flock here to witness the wonders he saw, like sea lions in the tropics. Giant tortoises that weigh more than 400 pounds. And marine iguanas, the only marine lizard left on Earth. More than a century and a half ago, these remarkable creatures prompted questions. And the answers radically changed our view of life. Now, the Galapagos is again a scientific frontier that's stimulating questions. But this time, the focus is on the coral reefs in nearby waters. Matias Espinosa has been a guide at the Galapagos National Park for 20 years.
You have this changing of temperature all the time in the Galapagos. So these are very hot conditions underwater. And it's very surprising that you have this coral still up to now here in the Galapagos. This strange ecosystem, it has very interesting behaviors. Incredible interaction.
The unusual conditions in the waters here have attracted the Khalid bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation. The foundation is sponsoring a five-year journey circumnavigating the globe on their vessel, Golden Shadow. Scientists aboard come and go at different research stops, focusing their studies on coral reefs and what we can do to help them survive the increasing dangers of climate change.
The Global Reef Expedition is an opportunity to really close scientific gaps in what we know about coral reef ecosystems. We're comparing very undisturbed reefs with highly populated and disturbed places with a lot of local stress from buildings and resorts and things like that.
The expedition began its study of reefs in the Caribbean Sea, where local development has severely impacted the corals. The Galapagos archipelago would seem to be the ideal contrast. There are only 25,000 inhabitants living on five of the main islands. The chain straddles the equator, 600 miles off the coast of Ecuador. But this location isn't typically tropical. It sits at the crossroads of five major currents, including the Humboldt or Peru current, which brings icy waters up from the Antarctic. water temperatures here can be cold, at the very edge of what corals need to survive. In fact, reefs here are such an oddity that they weren't even discovered until 1975. One of the men who first explored them is aboard today.
I was employed with the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in the 1970s in Panama. And we got word that some corals were being discovered in the Galapagos by Jerry Wellington, who was with the US Peace Corps at that time.
Peter Glynn quickly gathered a few other scientists and joined Wellington.
We chartered the Beagle, which was their research vessel at the Charles Darwin Station. And then we surveyed the corals all around the Galapagos Islands.
They discovered a surprising number of corals in the southern and central Galapagos and in the far northern islands.
They were totally healthy, very vibrant coral communities. All of the corals looked in excellent condition.
What they found was an ocean version of Eden, with warm and cold water creatures living side by side.
We were underwater filming a small patch reef in the southern Galapagos Islands, and then a penguin swam over the corals. And so this was certainly something that you wouldn't see very often. So that was pretty exciting.
Little did they know, the tragedy would strike just 7 years later. In 1982, El Nino brought unseasonably warm waters to the entire area.
We begin to hear stories about coral bleaching, turning white, and dying. In the Galapagos, the coral mortality at our study sites ranged anywhere from 95 to 97%, very high.
Before the corals had a chance to recover, tragedy struck again.
In 1997, 98, there was another very strong El Nino event. So we had two very strong events occurring just in one century. And so this was very unusual.
Now, Peter Glynn and the other scientists on the Golden Shadow are anxious to see how the corals have recovered since those fatal El Ninos. They head for the most extensive reefs Peter discovered. They're up north, near the islands of Wolf and Darwin. Throughout the Galapagos, the strong currents make this a very dangerous place to dive. So the scientists gather to prep the challenge.
So with the catamaran, maybe you can try to anchor with the catamaran around here.
Their local guide knows these waters well.
Well, sometimes there's a current, man, 2 knots like a river. So the best would be anchor the main mothership somewhere in the country.
The treacherous currents can kill the unwary.
Very strong current. My guess is that if you do the dives early in the morning, maybe the current is less strong, but it's going to increase as the day is going to pass on.
Everybody is up with the sun. Their schedule is ambitious. They'll dive 3 times a day at 8 different locations throughout the Galapagos. And all of that in 18 days. Some scientists have research projects and experiments they're pursuing. Brian Beck is calibrating a flow meter they'll take down to the ocean floor.
It's nice to look at the currents and correlate the strength of the current to what we see with the coral communities. So in areas, we might see a strange pattern in the coral communities that we can't quite explain, but then when we look at the current data, and sometimes that helps to inform us of why the coral communities are the way they are.
The ship's captain has his own challenges. There's no suitable anchorage here, so they'll have to drift.
And then we'll go for a boat ride.
As an extra precaution, the dive boat pulls another boat in case a diver needs to be rescued.
Somebody gonna jump in? Maybe ask Nick.
The scientists are all experienced divers. But in these cold, turbulent waters, they'll consume their air much faster. They've got to be careful. The first impression? For Brian, it's more fish than in your wildest dreams.
The schools of these fish are so thick that it makes photographing the corals almost impossible.
While some members of the team take photos to analyze up on deck, others count the fish that occupy a certain area. Everyone has a job to do.
So what I do is when I lay my line out is I record each species of coral that's within a half meter of that line. And I record the size and the health of that coral, how much is alive and dead. And the reason we do this is because work has been done here over time and we can see how these reefs are recovering or declining.
And they manage to do all this while getting thrown around by the current. Sometimes there are other distractions too.
I look up and I see this mass in the water coming toward me. And I realize it's a whale shark. Well over 30 feet long. It was truly amazing.
The waters here are also famous for another shark.
We see quite a lot of hammerheads in the water, and they're great to swim with. And we also see a lot of turtles around here. The green sea turtle is the most abundant in the Galapagos, which is a vital spot for their nesting.
These creatures still flourish in the Galapagos because the islands are so remote and isolated. And after several days of documenting the reefs, the scientists can see the impact that has on the corals too. The reefs are showing promising signs of recovery and attracting a wide variety of species. Across the world's oceans, coral reefs only take up about 0.1% of the sea floor. But their impact on ocean health is exponential. More than a quarter of all the fish in the sea spend part of their lives here. To Matthias, the corals of his home are impressive and critical to its bounty.
To have different kind of corals, we're talking about over 20 species of white corals and other cup tube corals and soft corals also. It was really a tremendous effort for the coral larvae to arrive and to survive under these very tough conditions.
There are fewer coral species in the Galapagos than in many reefs, because what's here has to be sturdy. There's Pavona, with a surface resembling little stars. Passalopera is a branching coral. These building blocks of the reef have recovered well from their bleaching trauma and are once again offering the sanctuaries ocean creatures need to thrive. The scientists have now surveyed all the northern reefs Peter helped identify 40 years ago. It's time to head south to see if those corals have fared as well. Along the way, there's time to appreciate the spectacular volcanic landscape. The history of the islands can be read in the layers of rock.
This is very interesting because this island is an uplifted island. That means that lava flow took place on the water. And with the pressure of the plates, that piece came out of the water.
The uplifted piece also tells a story about the corals here and the dramatic changes they've faced over time.
You see some layers here of white coral that shows you there was a lava flow on the water, then a long time of nothing that white coral could grow on the lava flow, and then another lava flow over it.
And of course, in geological time, corals have always come and gone depending on the climate and conditions on Earth.
The changes visible in these rocks occurred over millions of years. Today, our world is changing too, with serious implications for the health of our oceans. But it's happening at a much more accelerated pace. That's why these scientists are looking for signs of changes that might have occurred during the past few years that could shed light on how our oceans are coping. Derek Manzella is gathering water samples from different sites along the trip. He tests them for the amount of acidity or carbon dioxide in the water.
Since the Industrial Revolution, the combustion of fossil fuels by mankind has emitted a lot of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, and about 30% of that carbon dioxide has ended up in the world's oceans.
The speed at which our oceans are becoming more acidic has also increased in the past few decades. And that's very worrisome. What Derek studies is how this affects corals and ocean health and productivity.
There's a big element of discovery. There's really a lot of stuff we really don't know about how ocean acidification is going to affect marine organisms. So it's really kind of an undiscovered country.
Ileana Bombs has discovered a species of coral here that was previously thought only to occur in Hawaii.
It's very hard to distinguish visually from the most common of the reef-building species out here. It's a mounding coral, parietes, you see it very frequently. And you could then argue, well, what difference does it make? If you can't tell them apart, you know, what difference does it make? Well, the interesting part is that the two species seem to interact with the ecosystem in very different ways.
Ileana is staking out areas of the reefs, randomly sampling the two look-alike corals to see which one is more prevalent.
So we're taking these samples of these two different species, but in the lab we will then use certain DNA testing to tell the two different species apart.
This information could be valuable to resource managers as conditions change in the future.
One of the species deals with climate change differently. So when water temperatures get warm, one of the species bleaches more frequently than the other. If water temperatures keep rising with climate change, we might get one species to survive better than the other. So there might be a shift in the ecosystem.
I see you've got five divers on. 5 in the water, thank you.
As their floating laboratory moors in the southern Galapagos, the scientists recognize they've entered a very different ecosystem. They're closer to the equator, but you'd never know it. The water is really cold for diving, only 22 degrees centigrade. That's because they're a lot closer to the Humboldt Current, which carries icy water up from the Antarctic. Its powerful upwellings bring carbon dioxide up from the ocean depths, along with nutrients that attract thousands of fish and other creatures here to feed. These are garden eels, so shy you rarely get a photo of them. These white-tipped sharks are resting, which they often do during the day. They open and close their mouths to run water over their gills so they can breathe without moving. There's a lot to see down here. But as the scientists continue to explore, their hearts grow heavy. There's something very wrong. Peter Glynn remembers how these waters looked in 1975. There were healthy coral reefs then.
We thought there would never be a problem there, that coral reef development would continue into the future.
Now, some of the corals are eroded down to their bases. Others are infested with urchins, which burrow in and break down the reef skeletons. Patches of isolated corals fight on, but they're few and far between. It's clear that the reefs here in the southern Galapagos have not recovered since bleaching decades ago. But why? Derek's water samples may hold clues. He checks the numbers. Due to the current here, the CO2 level will naturally be higher, but the amount is a lot, twice what it was in the northern islands.
So this suggests that there might be some kind of threshold of carbon dioxide at which coral reefs can no longer recover from disturbance events.
If corals can't recover when CO2 is this high, that means they won't be able to handle the acidity level forecast for all the world's oceans by the year 2050. It's a frightening thought. But for the scientists, it's also an opportunity. It makes this particular area a natural laboratory to test the future. Scientific evidence has already shown high carbon dioxide makes it difficult for corals to build their skeletons and grow.
A good way to think about it is the animal is so stressed at almost a mortal threshold of stress that it really can't invest any energy or resource into growing a skeleton. It's really basically just hanging on for dear life.
Derek takes samples from some of the remaining corals. He'll study their growth patterns back in the lab and compare them to his northern samples.
What these corals will tell us is the growth rates of the species of coral that live here. And this is an important metric because it'll give us an idea of how much coral there really needs to be on the reef to maintain the reef structure.
And that's an important question for the future of our coral reefs. Is the high CO2 level here directly responsible for the failure of the corals to recover? And what will happen to other reefs around the world when bleachings are far more common as ocean temperatures increase? Here, in this natural laboratory that simulates the future, scientists are testing their hypotheses. And just as in Darwin's time, this remarkable ecosystem of the Galapagos is helping them seek answers, critical for saving the bounty of our oceans.
Thank you.